By now, we have explored the ideas of how the brain develops, what the different parts of the brain are, and how they function. One of the main characteristics of all living organisms is the ability to respond to stimulus. Like, remember that time you thought it was a cool idea to put salt on a slug or to pull a cat's tail? Well, maybe that was just me. Anyway, these are examples of a stimulus and the response that particular organism had. In order to respond to a stimulus, our brains have to receive things to make some sort of sense before responding. Sometimes the response is automatic, other times it's carefully calculated. We use many tools to make sense of the world. And that brings us to our topic today, which is perception. The essential idea here is that living organisms are able to detect changes in the environment. I would even take that further and say not only can we detect, but we respond. So focusing on humans here, we use our senses to perceive things: smell, taste, sight, sound, and touch. In this video, we're going to be focusing on how our brains detect these changes with a focus on these senses, and in particular, the eyes and the ears. Our bodies have many different types of receptors. These receptors pick up on a stimulus and transfer that stimulus into a signal that gets transmitted to a sensory nerve and ultimately processed, recognized, and made sense in our brains, and then transmitted again to the effector organ, which will respond to the stimulus. As you watch this presentation, you are using your eyes and your ears to receive the stimuli and process and send the signal to your brain, which then fires off a rapid succession of nerve impulses within your brain and to other parts of your body. It is quite fascinating, the intricate and complex processes that are seemingly made simple. You can see that in our bodies, we have four main types of receptors: mechanoreceptors that deal with sound waves, pressure, and touch; chemoreceptors that deal with chemicals, pH, and molecules; thermoreceptors that deal with hot and cold temperatures; and photoreceptors that deal with processing visible light. The organs that our bodies use to process these signals are very unique and have many intricate parts. One of those skills that you need to know is how to label the structure of the eye and the ear. You also need to know the various functions of the parts as well. So the best thing you can do is make up a Quizlet or flashcards and to really learn the functions. In this slide, you can see the human eye without labels and functions. In the next slide, it'll show all of the parts and the functions. So pause it if you need to, or just simply check out the slide's presentation. Here's the labeled structure of the eye. Have a glance and pause if you need to, but it's important to learn how to use these terms to know what they mean. Paramount to understanding how the eye works is understanding how light is received and processed by the eye. The part of the eye that is responsible for this is the retina. As you can see, the retina is a curved structure at the back of the eye. Specifically, it's the light-sensitive layer of tissue that forms the innermost coat of the internal surface of the eye, and it's kind of on the back. In this tissue, we have two specific types of cells that are called photoreceptors, where the light is received. These are the rods and the cones. Together, the rod and cone photoreceptors convert the light stimulus into nerve impulses. These nerve impulses are transmitted via bipolar cells to ganglion cells, whose fibers form the optic nerve tract. The photoreceptors line the rear of the retina, which is adjacent to the choroid, meaning light passes through the other cell layers that you can see here. Specifically, the step-by-step process is outlined here for you, and it's important to understand how to annotate a diagram like this one, but also know the underlying process. We will discuss some of the parts of this in the next few slides. As I just said, the rod and cones are both photoreceptors. So recall that photoreception is the way light is detected by the rod and cone cells and then converted into the nerve impulses. However, the rod cells and cone cells differ in both shape as well as their function. So both are absolutely necessary for having a full visual processing. You can see the cartoon-like illustration as well as the micrograph next to it. They definitely are different and distinguishable, and you can see it in the comparison chart below. Rod cells are abundant in the periphery of the retina and responsible for peripheral vision. They function better in low light conditions, so in the twilight, and they become quickly bleached in bright light. Rod cells all contain the same pigment, which absorbs a wide range of wavelengths and cannot differentiate between the different colors. Rod cells produce poorly resolved images, as many rod cells synapse with one single bipolar neuron. Cone cells, by comparison, are abundant at the center of the retina within the fovea and hence are involved in visual focusing. They function better in bright light conditions, so during the day, and require more photons of light to become activated. There are three different types of cone cells, each with a different pigment that absorbs a narrow range of wavelengths. Cone cells can therefore differentiate between different colors, specifically red, blue, and green, and each cone cell synapses with just one single bipolar neuron, so they produce well-defined images. And if you go back, you can see how the rod and cone cells synapse and the differences between those. Once the photoreceptors convert the light into a nerve impulse, this transmits an action potential to the bipolar nerve cells. As we pointed out in the last slide, many rod cells may synapse with a single bipolar cell, resulting in low resolution of sensory information, which is called poor acuity, whereas most cone cells only synapse with a single bipolar cell and results in high resolution of sensory information. The nerve impulse is then transmitted from the bipolar cells to the ganglion cells. Signals from the ganglion cells may be sent to the visual cortex to form a composite representation of surroundings, so sight. Also, signals may be sent to other brain regions to coordinate eye movements or maintain circadian rhythms, which, if you can recall, deals with the secretion of melatonin from the pineal gland. It is worth pointing out that there are no photoreceptors where the ganglion fibers feed into the optic nerve. This region is called the blind spot, as visual information cannot be processed at that location. However, the brain interpolates details from the surrounding regions so that individuals do not perceive a visual blind spot. In option A2, we learn that the brain processes contralaterally, meaning that a stimulus on one side of the body, let's say right side, is processed by the other side of the brain, in this case, the left side. We briefly touched on the eye as well. Our eyes are a little bit unique in the sense that both sides of the brain are responsible for processing information from both eyes. As you can see in the image, the right visual field for both eyes is received by the left parts of the eye and then processed by the left parts of the brain. This way, the visual fields are processed together. It's also worth pointing out that the optic nerve sends impulses to the thalamus, which then will be transmitted to the visual cortex. Parts of the thalamus are responsible for coordinating eye movements and monitoring and coordinating circadian rhythms. You might know someone who has issues perceiving colors. In other words, they are partially or completely colorblind. Maybe you are. Well, colorblindness is genetically inherited and has to do specifically with the cone cells in our retinas. We're not going to go into the specifics about genetic inheritance. That will be a different lecture. But the genes for the green and red photoreceptors is found on the X chromosome. If you recall, there are three different types of cone cells, each responsible for absorbing different wavelengths of light, whether it's green, red, or blue. In the genetic code for this gene, found on the X chromosome, there is a mutation that changes the way red and green are perceived, and the wavelengths cannot be distinguished. You can see in the images in the top right where someone who is not colorblind will be able to distinguish the numbers, where someone who is colorblind might see the bottom right image where the numbers are no longer able to be distinguished. As you might know, colorblindness can be tested for, and the specific name of this test is called the Ishihara color test, and that's what you can see in the slide. So the eyes are photoreceptors. Another receptor is the mechanoreceptor, which recognizes sound and pressure stimuli, converting vibrations in the air into action potentials. In humans, we process much of this in the ear. The ear is incredibly intricate, and with that, learning the parts and their function along with the location of these parts is something that you need to know. So here's the diagram for you. And here are the parts and the function. Just like the eye, you should make yourself a Quizlet and work on labeling the diagrams. And we'll be talking about some of these key parts in the next few slides. So looking at the diagram here at the bottom, this shows the direction and path that sound takes as it ultimately becomes a nerve impulse. You can see that we have three parts of the ear, outer, middle, and inner. As the sound travels into the auditory canal, this causes the eardrum to vibrate. The vibration of the eardrum changes depending on the frequency and intensity of the sound wave. The eardrum is the barrier between the outer ear and the middle ear. Once in the middle ear, the bones of the ossicles continue to transfer the vibrations to the oval window of the cochlea. This is the border of the middle ear and inner ear. The vibration from the oval window causes fluid in the cochlea to be displaced, so it moves, and then the hair-like cells in the ear detect this displacement and generate a nerve impulse. This nerve impulse is then transferred to the auditory nerve, which sends it on to the brain. During this process, the initial sound wave changes wavelengths as it travels through the various parts of the ear, and one of the functions of the bones in the ossicle is to amplify the vibration. Let's focus on the middle ear and how the structures help to transmit and amplify the sound waves. To recap what was in the last slide, the middle ear is separated from the outer ear by the eardrum and separated from the inner ear by the oval window. The middle ear is an air-filled chamber and contains the smallest bones in the human body, the malleus, incus, and stapes. They have cool nicknames as well. The malleus is the hammer, the incus is the anvil, and the stapes is the stirrup. You can see in the bottom image just how tiny they really are and why they have the nicknames they do. Looking at the looping video at the top, you can see the vibration reaches the eardrum it causes the whole contraption to transfer the vibration from the eardrum to the oval window. The oval window is smaller, and along with the shape of the bones, this enables the sound to be amplified so that it is not lost before it gets to the cochlear fluid. Once the vibration passes from the middle ear through the oval window, it reaches the inner ear. The inner ear is fluid-filled and is spiral in shape. Displacement of fluid by sound vibrations activates sensory hair cells within the spiral part of the cochlea, or the organ of Corti. The hair cells are the mechanoreceptors. They have hair-like extensions called stereocilia, and they're not actually hair, they're just kind of these wavy extensions. If you look at the breakdown of the word, I think of stereo meaning sound or solid, and cilia being the hair-like projections. You can see the micrograph image next to the diagram. The stereocilia vary in length and will resonate to a different frequency of sound. You can see in the image an example of one stereocilia, but think that we have many, many stereocilia, and depending on the frequency of the vibration, the stereocilia will move. Now, once the vibrations displace the cochlear fluid, that's when they move, causing the hair cells to depolarize and create an action potential. As you already are experts on, an action potential means a nerve impulse, and that is sent to the auditory nerve and onwards to the brain. However, our ears are still super fancy pants, and they do a number of really cool things for balance and spatial orientation. And a different part of the inner ear is used for balance and spatial orientation and can detect head movements. This specific part of the inner ear is called the semicircular canal. You might want to go back to the ear diagram for reference. The semicircular canal actually consists of three canals at 90 degree angles to each other, so head movement can be detected in different directions, so forward, sideways, and shaking it. When the head moves, the fluid in the semicircular canals follows the direction of movement, which is due to the inertia. This fluid movement exerts pressure on the hair cells embedded in the cupula, triggering nerve impulses. So not only are the ears dealing with sound, but they deal with moving fluids to help maintain balance. As you might imagine, someone with hearing challenges or loss might have issues with different parts of this process, or someone with conditions like vertigo or even dizziness has to do with the functioning of the cupula and inner ear. One specific application has to do with individuals that are deaf. There are many reasons that can cause a person to be born deaf or lose their hearing, such as genetics or diseases or other environmental factors. However, for some individuals, cochlear implants can be used in order to bypass many of the hearing process. Specifically, those individuals who have cochlear implants don't have functional hair cells called stereocilia. The cochlear implant has external parts with microphone and transmitter and internal parts the receiver and stimulator. The external components detect sound, filter out extraneous frequencies, and then transmit the signal to the internal parts. The internal components receive the transmissions and produce electrical signals via electrodes that are embedded into the cochlea. The electrical signal then gets transferred via the auditory nerve to be processed by the brain. By better understanding the applications and how the ear works, science and technology have developed ways to enable individuals having these types of conditions to lead better lives. Even hearing aids, which simply amplify the sounds, have bettered lives. The last type of receptor we're going to learn about is the detection of chemicals in the air by the olfactory system. Specifically, olfaction is the ability to detect airborne chemicals as scents or smells. Using the rose in the diagram as an example, let me go through that process. As you know, roses emit airborne chemicals. At the back of the nasal cavity is this patch of tissue called the olfactory epithelium, which is embedded with chemoreceptors. The olfactory epithelium is lined with mucus in which odorant molecules will dissolve before binding to the chemoreceptors. Binding of an odorant molecule triggers a nerve impulse, which is transferred via the olfactory bulb to the brain. The combination of olfactory receptors activated determines the specific scent perceived by the brain. As you know, the combination of neurons that gets triggered enables our brains to remember those scents and what they're associated with. So when you smell a rose, you know it's a rose. When you smell rotten eggs, you know it's a rotten egg smell. And for the majority of people, we can distinguish these smells. However, some people do have missing parts of this or cannot distinguish certain smells from other smells. Overall, option A3 is about perceptions and how the body has receptors that collect these signals, process them, and convert them into nerve impulses to be processed by the brain and interpreted. It's a fascinatingly complex process, but if we think about it, it happens so fast that we sometimes take it for granted. So hopefully you learned some pretty rad applications, and there are many, many connections that we can make from this unit, and many practical applications that scientists, engineers, and other people use as a result of the material you've learned today. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation script and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shoutouts to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IB Bio Ninja, and some of the information used. Other images and info come from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. So many thanks.